Good evening to all of you. Let me welcome all of you for the second leg of our cardiology update, online update. Today's presentation is done by Sri Jayawardenepura cardiology team. So let me invite the moderators for the day, Dr. Niyomali Amarasena, she's a senior consultant cardiologist at the Sri Jayawardenepura General Hospital. And she is the chairman of the subspecialty board of cardiology for the PGIM. Then my friend Dr. Jagat Therat, she is also a consultant cardiologist at the Sri Jayawardenepura General Hospital. I think let me invite one of you to introduce the speaker for the day.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry for the delay, everybody. I'd like to introduce Dr. Chatrika Vitana, who is the senior registrar in cardiology at the Jayawardenepura General Hospital. Chatrika has been she's training under my supervision, and I won't take too much time because of the delays. Already we were a bit worried whether she'll be ready for this, because she got a bad sinusitis, but fortunately she's up to it and she's ready to go. So go ahead, Chatrika.
Okay, thank you very much for your kind introduction, madam. Good evening, all of you. Let me thank Sri Lanka College of Cardiology first for organizing this sort of academic program for the senior registrars, and also for giving me this opportunity. And my special thanks goes to my supervisor, Dr. Niyomali Amarasena, as well as Dr. Jagat Therat, for guiding and motivating me to do the presentation today. Madam, I find difficult to share the screen.
Oh dear.
Host has disabled the screen sharing.
I think the host has to do that. Tamal, you might have to do it.
Yes, I've done that, madam. Huh? You should be able to do that now.
Right, I'll try again. Okay. Oh, okay, now.
Yeah. Okay, we can see you.
Can you see my screen?
Yes,
yeah,
we can see.
Yeah, you're fine.
Today my topic is coronary angiography, a guide to acquisition, interpretation, and reporting. Sounds very basic, but it's like the bread and butter of the interventional cardiology, and I'm sure most of you all are very much familiar with the content of this topic. Yet sometimes we tend to make mistakes upon reporting the angiograms, which brought about the importance of discussing and revising the basic knowledge. So I'll start with the topic.
Can you go to the slideshow and go to the full version?
Okay, sir, sure.
Slideshow.
Bottom.
I think I've done. Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Right. So coronary angiography is the radiographic visualization of the coronary vessels following injection of radiopaque contrast media. It remains the gold standard for detecting clinically significant atherosclerotic coronary artery disease. It was first performed by Dr. Mason Sons at the Cleveland Clinic in 1958. This is a picture of that historical moment. So we start with the coronary anatomy. This line diagram illustrates the blood supply of the heart. We'll discuss each one by one. As you all know, coronary arteries are epicardial and follow the sulci of the heart. A circle and half loop model has been introduced to illustrate the anatomic relationship among the arteries. Circle consists of the right coronary artery at the circumflex artery, and the half loop is formed by the LAD and the PDA. So we look at the left coronary artery first. Left median coronary artery originates from left posterior aortic sinus, just below the sinotibular ridge. As you know, there are three cusps in the aortic valve, and one anterior and two posterior, and left main is arising from the left posterior cusp. And that's why it lies in a plane somewhat above than the right coronary artery. Typically, it's about 5 to 10 millimeters length, And as you can see in this picture, it travels to the left of and posterior to the pulmonary trunk and bifurcates into LAD and circumflex. Left anterior descending artery travels down the anterior interventricular groove towards the apex. There are three types of LAD, type 1, 2, and 3. Type 1 LAD will stop short of the apex. Type 2 LAD will reach up to the apex. And type 3 LAD can be seen wrapping around the apex. This is what we call as the wraparound LAD. This diagram illustrates the three types of LAD, and this angiographic view on the right side shows the wraparound LAD. Why this is important and why you have to know about this is, I'll give you with an example. Recently, we had a patient who came with a STEMI, and there were ST elevation both on anterior LAD territory as well as right RCA territory. So we were a little surprised because it's less likely that one single patient is having ST elevation in two territories at the same time. Anyway, we proceeded with the angiogram. Then we found there's a mid-LAD lesion. At the same time, we noticed that there's a wraparound LAD. So it solved the problem. That's why the patient had ST elevations on anterior and inferior territory. So it's an anterior and inferior ST elevation in MI due to wraparound LAD. LAD gives off diagonals and septals and accounts for about 45 to 55% of blood supply of the left ventricle. Diagonals will supply anterior and anterolateral walls of the left ventricle as well as the anterolateral papillary muscle. That's why you can get the ischemic mitral regurgitation when there's an LAD infarction. Septals are intramyocardial and supplies the anterior two-thirds of the septum. Some people will have twin LADs, where we call as the dual LAD system, one for the entire septus and the other one for surface LAD. Angiographically, as this picture shows, there are four types of LAD systems, but radiographically, it's many more. Actually, there are 11 types. So we don't need to go into town on this. All what we have to know is if there's a dual LAD system, we need to mention it in our angiogram report, because it is important as far as the revascularization is concerned. So this angiographic view shows there's a short LAD which terminates shortly, which is giving septal perforators, and a long LAD which is giving diagonals as well as septal perforators. So we look at the left circumflex artery. It travels down in the left atrioventricular groove. It gives off obtuse marginal branches to lateral wall of left ventricle, and it accounts for about 15 to 25% of the blood supply of the left ventricle. In the left dominant system, it gives off PDE and PLV, accounting for about 40 to 50% of the blood supply of the left ventricle. Sometimes, left main trifurcates into LAD circumflex and ramus intermedius. Ramus intermedius has a similar course to that of diagonal of LAD and supplies the anterior wall of left ventricle. Then we look at the right coronary artery. It originates at right aortic sinus, as I already mentioned. That's why the right coronary artery lies somewhat lower and anterior to the origin of the left main coronary artery. So it passes to right and posterior to the pulmonary artery and downwards in the right atrioventricular groove towards crux of the heart. In a right dominant system, it gives off PDA from which septal perforators arise, and then continues in the left AV groove, giving off the posterior LV branch. Right coronary artery accounts for about 25 to 35% of blood supply of the left ventricle. Right coronary artery gives off a couple of branches, which you have to know, the first being the cornice artery, but 50% of the population will have a separate origin of the cornice artery. Cornice artery is the one which supplies the right ventricular outflow tract, and it's a very important source of collaterals when it comes to chronic total occlusions of right coronary artery. And then it gives off the SA nodal artery as the second branch, which supplies the SA node. And then RV branches are given off, which supply the free wall of the right ventricle. Then the acute marginal branch is given off, arising from the mid-RCA, and that supplies the anterior right ventricle. And again, this acute marginal branch is a good source of collaterals when it comes to CTOs of right coronary artery. Distally, RCA gives off the AV nodal artery at or near the crux, which supplies the AV node and then divided into PDA and PLV. PDA supplies the inferior wall of left ventricle, inferior one third of the septum, and posterior medial papillary muscle, whereas PLV continues from crux to left entrave groove and meet the circumflex artery. Bit about the coronary artery dominance. This depends on the blood supply to the inferior wall of the left ventricle, whichever the artery crosses the crux and gives off the PDAs, giving off the septal perforators, is considered to be the dominant artery. Majority of the population, about 85%, are right dominant, and PDA and PLV both arise from the right coronary artery, as this diagram shows. 7 to 8% are left dominant, where the PDA and PLV both arising from the circumflex. And 7 to 8% are co-dominant, where the RCA gives PDA and circumflex gives the PLV. Then we'll move on to the coronary artery nomenclature. Now, when we are describing a lesion on an angiogram, as we are describing as proximal vessel lesion, mid vessel lesion, distal vessel lesion. But are we doing it according to the correct terminology? We'll go through and see. According to the American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association classification, coronary artery is divided into 29 segments. This picture shows all these 29 segments. The left main coronary artery is defined as from the ostium to the bifurcation of LAD and circumflex. So when you take a left main ostial lesion, it's the origin of left main coronary artery, including the first 3 millimeters of the vessel. So if you say it's an ostial left main lesion, it should be either at the origin or within the first 3 millimeters of the vessel. But if it is continuous beyond first 3 millimeters, it's an osteoproximal lesion. And if that lesion starts after the first 3 millimeters, it's not an ostial lesion, it's a proximal lesion. So this 3 millimeter definition applies to all ostial lesions. Same as for the LAD ostium, it's again the first 3 millimeters from the origin. Then proximal LAD is defined as from the origin to the first septal perforator. Mind you, it's the first septal perforator and not the diagonal. And mid LAD is the middle portion from first septal to the third septal perforator. And distal LAD is from third septal perforator to the terminus. In a particular angiogram report, we talk about only up to a maximum of 3 diagonals, which are the longest branches originating from LAD to supply the anterolateral wall. Septal perforators originate from LAD to supply intraventricular septum. Then the circumflex ostium, again, it's the origin and the first 3 millimeters. Proximal circumflex is defined as the proximal portion from ostium to first OM1. And mid-circumflex, it's middle portion from OM1 to OM2. This you have to remember. In mid-circumflex, it's middle portion from OM1 to OM3, whereas mid-LAD is middle portion from SP1 to SP3. The distal circumflex is from the origin of OM2 to the terminus. So again, in an angiogram report, we talk about up to a maximum of 3 obtuse marginal branches, which are the longest branches originating from circumflex to supply the lateral wall. In a left dominant system, we have to describe about the left PDA and PLV as well. Ramus intermedius is the branch vessel whose origin bisects the origins of LAD and circumflex. Then we'll go to the RCA nomenclature. Ostium is again the origin and the first 3 millimeters. As this picture shows, proximal RCA is from the origin to the first RV branch, and mid RCA is from first RV branch to the acute marginal branch. Distal RCA is from the origin of acute marginal branch to the origin of PDA or to the crux. So PDA is the vessel runs in the posterior interventricular groove giving septal perforators, and PLV is the distal continuation of RCA in posterior AV groove after giving PDA. Then we come to the angiographic imaging. Basic principle is radiation produced by X-ray tube is attenuated when it passes through the body and detected by image intensifier. Iodinated contrast medium injected into coronaries enhances X-ray absorption and produces a sharp contrast image. X-ray shadow is then converted into a visible light image by image intensifier displayed on fluoroscopic monitors and stored on cinefilm or digital storage system. As you can see, Now you are familiar with this cath lab setting, and X-ray tube is kept below the patient, and image intensifier is kept above the patient, and the two is connected to the C-arm, and patient lying supine on the bed. The C-arm can be moved in two different planes. So the one movement is we call as rotation, the other one is the angulation. Rotation describes the position of image intensifier around the longitudinal axis of the patient. So LAO refers to rotating the camera to patient's left, whereas RAO to the right. Angulation describes the position of image intensifier in the short axis of the patient. Camera can move towards the head, then we call it cranial, and when it is moved towards the foot end, it's caudal. So this picture shows all the standard angulations and rotation waves. So here, the image intensifier in the central picture, the image intensifier is kept below the patient. Sorry, X-ray tube is kept below the patient, and image intensifier is kept above the patient. And it lies in a vertical plane, the patient, and we call this as the AP view. And when this image intensifier is moved to the right side of the patient, we call it as a RAO view. And when it is rotated to the left side, it's a LAO view. And here, when the image intensifier is angulated towards the head end, it's the cranial view. And when it is angulated to the foot end, it's the caudal view. So rotation and angulation can be combined, and we can get the necessary angiographic projection. When it comes to coronary views, there are certain anatomic landmarks. Anatomic landmarks are formed by three things. Those are spine, catheter, and diaphragm. This can be used to find out which image is taken, especially this is for the beginners. In LAO view, catheter and spine seen on the right side of the image. You can see in this third picture, this is an LAO cranial view. The spine lies on the right side of the picture. In RAO view, they are found on the left side. The first picture shows the RAO caudal view, and the catheter lies on the left side. In AP view, these landmarks are in the center of the image. Cranial angulation can usually be distinguished from caudal angulation by presence of the diaphragm shadow. So we'll go through each and every standard angiographic view one by one. Let's first start with the right coronary artery. So this is the LAO view, or left anterior oblique view. In this view, we rotate the image intensifier 30 degrees to the left. This is the projection we use to engage the right coronary artery. As you can see, right coronary artery appears in the shape of the letter C on this view. This is best for demonstrating ostium of the right coronary artery as well as the proximal and mid portion. Then the LAO cranial view. Here we rotate the image intensifier 30 degrees to the left and angulate it again 30 degrees cranially as a standard. So this gives a clear demarcation of the crux with the separation of PDA and PLV. So it's best for visualizing the distal RC. Some operators prefer to get AP cranial view, again for visualization of distal RCA. Both are more or less according to the patient's anatomy, you can go to a preferable view. Then we come to the RAO view. Here the image intensifier is rotated 30 degrees to the right of the patient. As you can see in this view, ostium and proximal right coronary artery appears foreshortened, but it's the best view to visualize the mid-RCA. In this view, left ventricular apex lies on the right side of the projection. Thus the PDA as well as acute marginal branch, RV marginal branch, all course towards the right side of the screen. SA nodal artery and the AV nodal artery course towards the left side of the screen. Especially upon wire manipulation, when it comes to angioplasty, when there's superimposition of the RCA proper with the acute marginal branch, this view gives a better idea separating the two from each other. So this is a summary of the right coronary artery views. Some operators prefer to get LAO caudal view particularly when they want to visualize the right coronary artery ostium. But as a standard view, we don't really take that. But during the angiography, angioplasty, if necessary, we can have a lower caudal view for the osteal visualization. Then we come to the left coronary artery. We'll start with the AP caudal view. Here, in each diagram, the image intensifier and the line diagram, as well as the angiographic view. So here, the image intensifier is moved 40 degrees towards the foot end. This is the first image that we take upon angiography in our cath lab setting. This view shows left main, proximal LAD, and circumflex in its full length with the branches. So it's a very good working view for the circumflex lesions. This is the RAO caudal view. Here the image intensifier is rotated to the 30 degrees to the right and angulated 30 degrees towards foot end. The origin and cause of the origin and cause of the cell as the ramus intermedius is clearly seen on this view. Proximal LAD also clearly seen on this view, but beyond that, it's mid and distal LAD appears foreshortening. And this is again one of the best views for the visualization of circumflex. Then we move on to the LAO caudal view, the so-called spider view. Why we call it as a spider view? Because the appearance of the vessel resembles a spider. And there's a mnemonic to remember. We all know that is SAD, because septals lie first on the projection, and then the anterior descending artery, and the diagonals. This shows left main and the bifurcation into LAD and circumflex very well. But here, the left main is slightly foreshortened. Proximal and mid portions of the circumflex artery is very well seen. But the drawback of this view is the X-ray penetration is less on spider view. And superimposition of the diaphragmatic shadow also accounts for the poor image quality. But still, this is a very good view to visualize the LMCA, LAD, and circumflex, all three. In angioplasty, it's a quite important view, and some operators prefer to have this view as the first view, because if there's any left main pathology, by looking at this view, you can get a better idea and then proceed accordingly. Good separation of the vessel is sometimes difficult in vertically displaced hearts, as an example, in COPD patients. In that case, you might have to increase the angulation to increase the caudal angulation as well as the rotation to the left side to get a better quality view with better separation of the vessels. Then we'll go to the AP cranial view. This view separates proximal and mid LAD from diagonal branches, which run to the right side of the screen, and the septal branches, which run to the left side of the screen. So this is a very good working view for the LAD artery during angioplasty. And this is the RAO cranial view. It is used to see the origins of the diagonals along the mid and distal LAD. Diagonal branches are well visualized, projecting upwards on this projection. Proximal LAD and circumflex are slightly overlapped, and circumflex is foreshortened on this view. So it is again good for a good as a working view for the LAD. Then we'll come to the LAO cranial view. As a routine, we don't usually get this view, but during the good old days, when the femoral angiography was the only sort of access for the angiography, operators preferred to do this view to visualize the LAD. Here, there's better separation of septals as well as diagonals, where the diagonals course towards the right of the screen and septals course towards the left. The problem with this image is when we are taking this view, the image intensifier is rotated 30 degrees to the left and angulated again 30 degrees towards patient's head then. So image intensifier is directly looking towards the operator. So the radiation risk to the operator is very high upon this view. That's why we don't take it as a routine view during standard angiography, but during angioplasty, for the wire manipulation, this is a very good view to visualize LADs and the origins of the diagonals. And again here, proximal and mid-circumflex is slightly foreshortened, but it's very good view for a visualization of the distal circumflex, particularly as the below picture shows, it is the best view to visualize the dominant circumflex during angiography. Then what about the lateral view? Is there a significance? When we take the lateral view, the image intensifier is moved 90 degrees and the C-arm is kept almost parallel to the flow. This is a good view to visualize the mid and distal LADs, and also in when it comes to graft angiography, it's a very good view to visualize the graft and native vessel anastomosis. But there are certain drawbacks on this view. One thing is we need to position patient's hand to avoid the superimposition of hands on the angiographic image. Second thing is this carries the maximum amount of radiation exposure to the operator. Because of these two reasons, nowadays the lateral view is not practiced as a routine view, but wherever necessary, we can take the lateral view as well. Then what about the critical left field stenosis? Yes, in this kind of situation, you have to limit the number of fields, because in a critical left main stenosis, anyway, the PCI is out of the therapeutic option. So we don't need more and more angiographic views. All what we have to do is we have to give adequate amount to the surgeon to proceed with the bypass surgery. For that, we need to take only three views, preferably AP caudal, LA caudal, and AP cranial. AP caudal visualizes the circumflex, LA caudal visualizes the left main and the bifurcation, AP cranial giving a better idea about the LAD. This slide summarizes the views that we have to take to visualize the each segment of the coronary artery, and all that I have discussed so far. So a bit about the left ventricle in LAO versus RAO waves. This again, the operator has to understand. Heart is the size of a fist. What you have to understand is when you come to LAO view, the heart is made shorter and rounder. And when you go to RAO view, it's elongated. So this is the appearance on LVON fluoroscopy or ventriculography. So this is the LAO view. You can see the segments are marked. This is the basal segment, lateral segment, apical segment, and the septum. So in the LAO projection, we don't see the inferior wall of the left ventricle. Whereas in RAO view, we see the basal anterior position, then the anterior wall, then the apex inferior wall, and the basal inferior segment. So in RAO view, we don't see the lateral wall of the ventricle. So if you have that idea, it's good, then because you can get an idea about regional wall motion abnormality on fluoroscopy. Then we'll move on to the interpretation of an angiogram. Angiographically, coronary artery is defined as presence of any degree of narrowing in at least one major arteries or their first degree branches. Obstructive coronary artery disease is defined as more than 50% diameter stenosis by visual estimation of lesion diameter compared with adjacent normal segment. So if it is less than 50% diameter stenosis, it's called as non-obstructive coronary artery disease. That doesn't mean it's benign, because plaque rupture can occur at any time, but for the present moment, it doesn't cause any obstruction to the flow. Then you have to assess the severity going by the visual assessment. If it is less than 50%, it's a mild stenosis. 50 to 70% is a moderate stenosis. 70 to 99% severe stenosis and 100% is occlusion. Hemodynamically significant stenosis are those more than 70% for all the coronary arteries except for left main, where more than 50% stenosis is considered significant. This diagram gives a better idea about the lesion severity. This figure, this vessel doesn't have any plaque, and picture number one shows a minor plaque, and picture number two, it's a moderate plaque, and picture number three, just a significant plaque, and here it shows occlusion. Mind you, even with best operators, there can be certain degree of variability when it comes to angiographic assessment of the lesion severity. At the same time, they have found with subsequent imaging studies and physiological studies, by going by the visual estimation, there can be 20% of underestimation of lesion assessment can take place. As an example, here there's 50% lesion. It's a moderate plaque. But when you do the imaging studies, it may be more than that, maybe around 75%. So what we have to know is that when we go only by the visual assessment, so to avoid this, what we have to do is we have to go by the clinical picture. When you do the angiogram, just though it appears a moderate plaque, just see whether there's any color difference when you compare with the rest of the segments of the artery and whether there's any haziness. And if you have any doubt, you have to proceed with either physiological studies like FFR or imaging studies like IVSO OCT to give a correct assessment of the lesion severity. When you are interpreting an angiogram, you need to mention about these things: number of diseased vessels, lesion quantification in at least two orthogonal views in mentioning the lesion severity, degree of calcification, degree of toxicity and angulation, presence of ulceration, thrombus, dissection, aneurysm, ectatic segment, etc. And wherever necessary, you have to mention the ACC-AHA lesion grading according to the current classification. And again, wherever it is necessary, TIMI flow grading also has to be mentioned. And when there are CTOs, identifying and quantifying collateral formation is also important. So we'll come to the lesion description. As you all know, if there are more than 70% lesion, so if there's a significant plaque in a major vessel or in its first order branch, then we call it significant plaque disease. So when we mention about LAD, LAD includes LAD diagonal septus as well as ramus intermedius. This is a problematic OM branches, and the right coronary artery includes RCA proper, RV marginal, PDA and PLV. So if there are 70% lesions in LAD and D1, still it's a single vessel. And if there are more than 70% lesions in LAD and OM, it's a double vessel disease. And if there are 70% lesions in LAD, are ramus intermedius and right coronary artery. Though there are three vessels, still it's a double vessel disease because our right or ramus intermedius comes under LAD as it has the cause similar to the diagonals. And when there's a left main disease, ideally it has to be a double vessel disease because the left main is the one which is bifurcating to LAD and circumflex. But in the practical setting, we don't mention like that, and we mention as critical left main disease. Then the length of the lesion measured from shoulder to shoulder in an unforeshortened view. If it is less than 10 millimeter, it's a discrete lesion. And if it is about 10 to 20 millimeter, it's a tubular lesion. And if it is more than 20 millimeter, it's a diffuse lesion. And you have to mention whether it's an eccentric lesion or a concentric lesion. The second picture is a concentric lesion, which shows symmetric narrowing of coronary artery. And here it's an eccentric lesion where there's an asymmetrical narrowing of the coronary artery. And we have to use certain terminology when we describe the lesions sometimes. Tandem lesions is one such thing. When there are two lesions closely abut each other, one behind the other with an intervening normal segment, we call it as a tandem lesion. Why I have shown this picture is because bullets are loaded in a tandem fashion in a gun. Likewise, there are two lesions here with an in-between normal segment, where we call as a tandem lesion. Sequential lesions are two lesions located at a distance longer than the balloon length. Then, if possible, we have to mention about the contour, whether it's a smooth or an irregular or an ulcerated flap. Then, proximal vessel tortuosity is also important because that is necessary to decide whether we are proceeding with angioplasty or surgeon and balloon manipulation. Proximal vessel tortuosity also matters a lot. So it is defined as number of more than 75 degree bends to reach the lesion. This picture shows highly tortuous vessel. You can see all are more than 75 degree bends. This is again the same. So if it is on one such bend, we call mildly tortuous artery. There are two bends, it's a moderate tortuous artery. And if there are more than three bends, it's a severely tortuous artery. Then the lesion angulation also important. Angulation is defined as more than 45 degrees angulation within the lesion. If the lesion is located on a straight segment, you don't have to worry. But if the lesion is located on a bend less than 45 degrees, it's a mildly angulated lesion. If it is located on a 45 to 90 degrees bend, it's a moderately angulated lesion. And if it is located on more than 90 degrees bend, it's a severely angulated lesion. Then, upon angiography, you have to assess the degree of calcification as well. Mild calcification means density is noted only after contrast injection. Moderate calcification means density is noted only with cardiac motion prior to contrast injection. And severe calcification is radiopacity is noted without cardiac motion prior to contrast injection, which we see, usually see on fluoroscopy. Sometimes there can be thrombus. Thrombus is a discrete intraluminal filling defect with defined borders and is largely separated from adjacent vessels. There may or may not be contrast staining. As you can see here, there's 100% occlusion of this OM branch with the thrombus. A word about chronic total occlusions. Chronic total occlusions are completely occluded coronary arteries with TIMI zero flow with an estimated duration of at least 3 months. Angiographic review should focus on four characteristics of the CTO. Firstly, it's the proximal cap morphology, whether it's a tapered dent or a blunted dent. Secondly, the occlusion length, course, and the composition. To get a better idea about the occlusion length, sometimes you might have to do dual injections. And then thirdly, you have to assess the quality of the distal vessel. And then fourthly, characteristics of the collateral circulation also important. All these factors matters to decide on successful and safest crossing strategies. So what are the collaterals in CTOs? In lay terms, those are natural bypasses where there's anastomotic connections without an intervening capillary bed between portions of the same coronary artery or between different arteries. Collaterals offers an important alternative source of blood supplies when the original vessel fails to provide sufficient blood to a territory. 22 anatomical pathways are described in literature according to Levine's classification, but these are summarized in four categories. We don't need to describe all these types, but if we can identify the category of the collateral, that is more than enough. So those are the intra-arterial or ipsilateral or bridging collaterals. Other thing is septal collaterals. The third one is epicardial vessel with proximal takeoff. And fourth one is epicardial collaterals with distal takeoff. These are the patterns of collaterals you get in RCA. It's septal collaterals, where there are collaterals formed between the septal perforators of the LAD and the PDA. And here, these are bridging or ipsilateral collaterals. And these are this epicardial collaterals with distal takeoff, and these are the epicardial vessel collaterals with proximal takeoff. These are the collateral types you see in LAD occlusion. And this is about circumflex CTOs. The collateral filling of the recipient artery was assessed according to Rentrop classification. There are four grades in Rentrop classification that you have to know and mention wherever necessary. Grade 0 means no filling of collaterals. Grade 1 is side branch filling of the recipient artery without filling of the main epicardial artery. Grade 2 is partial filling of the main epicardial recipient artery. And grade 3 is complete filling of main epicardial recipient artery. This picture shows the four gradings. This is the grade 0, where there is no significant collateral formation. This is LAD CTO and RCA is injected here. And picture B, again, there's a LAD CTO and the RCA giving collaterals, side branch-like collaterals, but there's no opacification of the LAD. So this is the grade, the RCA CTO, and LAD is giving collaterals to RCA with epicardial vessel filling up to a certain extent. So it's a grade 2 collateral formation. And here it's again LAD CTO, and RCA gives off collaterals. As you can see, there's complete filling of LAD up to the top. So this is the grade 3 according to the Rentrop classification. So most of the CTOs which we do angioplasty belongs to either grade 2 or 3 according to the Rentrop classification. Little bit about the bifurcation lesions. Bifurcation lesion is a lesion occurs at or near a division of a major coronary artery. Here we need to assess the lesion in three anatomic segments: proximal main branch, distal main branch, and side branch. There are numerous classification systems, but simplest and most widely used is the Medina classification, which assesses plaque burden based on presence or absence of stenosis in proximal main branch, distal main branch, and the side branch. This picture shows, summarizes the Medina classification. So if the plaque is more than 50%, we consider it as 1. If it is less than 50%, we give it as 0. Then first we assess the proximal main branch. Then secondly, we assess the distal main branch. And thirdly, we assess the side branch. So here, there's more than 50% plaque in proximal main branch, distal main branch, as well as the side branch. So it's a Medina 1-1-1. And here, there's more than 50% plaque in proximal main branch and distal main branch, but no plaque on side branch. So it's Medina 1-1, no. Likewise, there are 7 patterns according to the Medina classification. And wherever necessary, when there's a bifurcation lesion, you have to give that idea on your angiogram report. Depending on these characteristics, AHA and ACC have graded the lesions into 3 groups, type A, B, and C. Type A lesions are the discrete, concentric, readily accessible, with a smooth contour without any calcium, and there's no CTO segment at all, and those are not austere in location or no side branch involvement. So type A lesions carries high success rate when it comes to angioplasty, and it exerts low risk upon angioplasty. And type B lesions, again, there are a couple of criteria. If only one criteria is present, they grade it as type B1. And if there are more than 2 criteria present, it's type B2. This carries the moderate success. Type C lesions are the diffuse, accessibly tortuous, located in excessively angulated segment with the CTO segments. These kind of type C lesions carry high risk during angioplasty, and there may be low success rates. These are the other things that you see during the angiogram: aneurysms and ectasia. So what is the difference? Both are characterized by an abnormal dilatation of coronary arteries, where aneurysm is a focal dilatation and ectasia is a diffuse dilatation. That is the difference. Both are more than 1.5 times the neighboring segment. The dilatation is more than 1.5 times the neighboring segment. In an ectatic artery, this dilatation involves more than 50% or more of the length of the coronary artery, whereas in aneurysm, it is less than 50%. Mainly, the etiology is atherosclerosis, but that can occur in Kawasaki's disease, inflammatory disease, trauma, or connective tissue disease. So if there's no obvious etiology like atherosclerosis, then you need to evaluate for the possible etiology when you find aneurysms or ectatic segments. Then coronary fistulas. Fistula is a connection between a coronary artery and a cardiac chamber or a great vessel, with the connection bypassing the myocardial capillary bed. Mostly congenital, but can occur after the cardiac surgery. Fistulas can arise from many sites. The commonest site is the right coronary artery, followed by LAD and the circumflex. This picture shows two fistulas. This arising from the circumflex artery and going up to the pulmonary trunk. And here, another fistula occurring from the circumflex artery and going into the right ventricle. So you can see, more proximal the origin, more dilated the feeding artery. And when drains into right side, there can be direct volume overload to the pulmonary circulation. When it is draining to the left side, it spares pulmonary circulation, but there's again volume overload to the left ventricle, which can mimic with the clinical features of aortic regurgitation. This is just for your interest. Different types of fistulas. Here the fistula from right coronary artery to the right atrium. Here fistula from right coronary artery as well as left coronary artery draining to right ventricle, and fistula from left coronary artery to the right atrium. And here the fistula from left coronary artery to the coronary sinus. So most of the time this remains asymptomatic. If they remain asymptomatic, you don't need to intervene. But you have to mention on your angiogram if you see the fistula on angiography. So a word about muscle bridge. Muscle bridge is the muscle overlying the intramyocardial segment of an epicardial coronary artery. This is congenital in nature, characterized by systolic compression of the tunnel segment. As you can see, it appears completely normal during the diastole, but during systole, there's compression at the muscle bridge. Muscle bridge is mostly located in the mid segment of the LAD with a typical length of 1 to 3 centimeters. Mostly they remain asymptomatic, but sometimes can produce myocardial ischemia. Diagnosed on angiography with the typical milking effect, and two treatment strategies have been explored. One is negative inotropic or chronotropic agents like beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. But if there's no response to the medical management and patient is symptomatic, then you have to go for a surgical myotomy or CABG. This, of course, I'm sure you're familiar with this. This is the TIMI flow grading. This gives a qualitative assessment of blood flow by observing the distal runoff in a vessel, classified into 4 grades. As this picture shows, TIMI 0 grade is the no flow beyond the total occlusion. And TIMI 1 is some contrast filling is there beyond the culprit relation, but there's no satisfactory anti-grade flow. In TIMI 2, distal flow in the arteries there, but less than non-infarct arteries. In TIMI 3, the flow rate is equal to that in the non-infarct arteries. So if it, most of the time we see the TIMI 3 flow, then you don't need to mention, but if you are worried of slow flow or the flow is not satisfactory, that TIMI grading also to be mentioned on your angiogram report. So the TIMI frame count gives a quantitative assessment of the distal blood flow. TIMI flow gives a qualitative assessment. Here, we can give a quantitative assessment of the distal blood flow. It is assessed with the use of 6 French catheter and filming rate is set at 30 frames per second. Number of cine films from the introduction of dye in the coronary artery to a predetermined distal landmark is counted. And we take the first frame where the dye fully opacifies the artery origin and in which dye extends across the width of the artery, touching both borders with anti-grade motion of dye. Distal landmarks are predetermined. For LAD, it's the distal bifurcation of the LAD artery. For circumflex, it's distal bifurcation of branch segments with the longest total distance. And for RCF, it's first branch of the PLV. And the normal TIMI frame count for LAD is 36, for circumflex is 22, and for the RCA, it's 20. You can understand that by looking at this diagram. So here, you can see the dye enters to the vessel, but we don't take it as the first frame because it doesn't fulfill that definition. So this has to be taken as the first frame where dye touches both borders and moves forwards. Then the last film, where the dye first enters the predetermined landmark. So this is not the correct thing to take as the last cine film. And the second one is the correct one, where the dye first enters the determined landmark. And this picture shows the predetermined landmarks for the three vessels, which I mentioned earlier. Lastly, we'll come on to the bypass graft angiography. Bypass graft angiography needs to assess the patency of bypass graft in patients with angina. Unlike the native vessel angiography, this is more complex and challenging. So therefore, as an operator, always go through the surgical notes before attempting. That is important to know the number and types of graft in order to reduce radiation exposure, contrast use, procedural time, and subsequently the risk to the patient. As a standard, we do the native vessel angiography first, followed by graft vessel angiography next. There's a reason for doing that, because then we can get a better idea regarding the native vessels. And also at the same time, we can visualize whether there's competitive flow in the grafted vessels. By looking at that, we can get an idea whether the grafts are patent, or if the competitive flow is not seen, we can get some sort of idea whether the graft is blocked. So having done the native vessel angiography, we'll proceed with the graft angiography. So we'll start with the saphenous vein graft. Proximal anastomosis sites lie superior to native coronary ostia. It lies several centimeters above the sinuses of Valsalva. As you can see here, RCA usually have, RCA grafts usually have right-sided takeoff from the aorta. And left coronary grafts have an anterior takeoff. Typically, there's a predictable sequence. RCA grafts placed most inferiorly, followed by LAD grafts, followed by diagonal grafts, and the OM grafts have the highest takeoff. When you do the graft angiography, each graft should be visualized at least in two views, LAO and RAO. Right coronary artery grafts can be cannulated in LAO projection, just as the native RCA, while left coronary artery grafts can be cannulated in RAO projection. When you do the graft angiography, you should show the aortic anastomosis, body of the graft, distal runoff, and distal anastomosis. So, what is the best view of the best view to visualize the graft? Again, it's same as the native vessel, so it's easier. So, for the RCA, it's either LAO or AP cranial view, and for the LAD, it's lateral, but we usually don't take the lateral view, so it's either RAO or LAO cranial view. And for the circumflex, it's a caudal view, either LAO caudal or RAO caudal. And for the diagonal graphs, it's either iliocranial or areocranial view. So this picture shows OM graft. This is a saphenous vein graft to OM. And this is the ileo view. And this is the areo view. And here again, a saphenous vein graft is shown. This is the PDA graft. And this is the ileo view. And this is the areo view. Occluded grafts will appear as stump upon selective injection. If a graft cannot be cannulated, different catheters or different angulations should be tried. If still fails, aortogram is recommended. Having done the saphenous vein grafts, you have to proceed with the mammary graft. As you all know, lima is a branch of the left subclavian artery. Here there's a lima graft, so LAD and complex as well. So the lima graft can be engaged either in AP, RAO, or LAO views. Easiest is the RAO view. And best view for lima to LAD graft is just as for the native LAD, either LAO cranial or RAO cranial. Anastomosis is well visualized on lateral view, but we don't need to go for the lateral view. The LAO cranial or RAO cranial view with adequate panning will give adequate information. And when you want to visualize the rima graft, here the rima graft is grafted at the PDA. AP or LAO view are the better projections. This is again a picture of the native vessel angiogram as well as the graft vessel angiogram. Just two pictures shows this is the native left coronary artery and this is the native right coronary artery. And these three are the grafts. Here there's a saphenous vein graft to OM. And here it's a saphenous vein graft to PDA in showing the RAO view. And here there's a lima graft to LAD. This table summarizes the appropriate views on graft angiography. That is all that I have mentioned so far. Little bit about the ascending aortography. It is necessary to determine position and no patency of bypass grafts, degree of aortic insufficiency, or to exclude aortic dissection. Done with pigtail catheter, keeping the catheter just above the valve. Usually we set the flow rate at 15 to 20 milliliters per second, and total volume of contrast we inject is about 40 to 60 milliliters. It is performed in two projections, LAO and RAO. LAO view is good to identify dissections in ascending aorta, to delineate the aortic arch and the great vessels. RAO view is helpful to see thoracic aorta, origin of the graft, the left coronary system, and to assess the aortic regurgitation. Usually we don't angulate either cranially or caudally, but if you're finding for a missing graft, you might have to go for a little cranial or caudal angulation accordingly. So what are the pitfalls in angiographic interpretation? One thing is coronary artery. Here, the first picture shows diffuse coronary artery spasms. This can be overcome by giving intracoronary GTM. So the picture below shows the normal coronaries, actually same patient's angio vessels after giving an intracoronary GTN. Then second problem we encounter is the vessel overlap. This can be avoided by taking different views and adjusting the angle as well as the rotation. Then inadequate vessel opacification is another problem because even a normal segment will appear as a lesion if you don't give adequate dye. That could be due to inadequacy of the amount of contrast we give, or else due to excessive dilution of the contrast. So that has to be avoided to give a better interpretation. Then foreshortening is another problem. To look at least two orthogonal views is important. And to visualize each segment, you should select the best view to avoid foreshortening. And dominance determination also will be problem sometimes, but most of the time it's right dominant. But when there's left dominance, you might be having some hesitation whether it's left dominant or right dominant or co-dominant. So the best view is to go with the ileocranial view, where you can visualize the dominant circumflex very nicely and can sort out the problem. Then the lesion severity assessment, as I already mentioned, there can be underestimation of lesions. So lesion severity assessment by visual assessment. So wherever necessary, you have to combine or proceed with either physiological studies like FFR or imaging study like IVUS or OCT if it is available. So in summary, angiographic views, coronary nomenclature, and lesion description are the basics of interventional cardiology. All the operators should have a sound knowledge on these. Solid basic knowledge is the platform to start success to go for a better patient management. Thank you for your patience.
So thank you, Chatrika, for the comprehensive evaluation of coronary arteries. I think we are ready for some questions.
The chat box has got some questions.
Yeah. Congratulations, Chatrika, very comprehensive lecture. There was a question sent by, I think, Anjan Anujan. He has asked whether the combination of LCX and Ramus intermediate would be double vessel or not. Could you? Hello?
It's a double vessel.
It's double vessel. That's the thing.
Because
Ramus
intermedius is considered under LAD.
LAD, no?
Yes.
Considered
a branch of the LAD.
Yeah.
Well,
branch of the LAD because it has
a
similar cross as diagonal.
That's right, yeah.
So if it is D1 only, it's still single vessel?
Still single vessel. Yes.
Huh? Although angiogram is a bread and butter, all of us know that every time we do a cath session, there's something challenging. It has always been that, at least engagement, interpretation, it's always been a challenge. So I think a lot of us will have the experience to talk here about problems that they face in the cath lab. One thing I noticed one day was the guide had accidentally passed into the when I was in RC and accidentally gone into the RV cavity. I immediately pulled out, but later when I went through the literature, there could be connections from the coronary joining the ventricles. Those are coronary cameral fistulas. So the initial reaction is to pull the wire out, but later I went to the literature, some of them have been used for stabilizing the wire and then delivering devices. So I think if you see something like that, don't panic, which I panicked actually one day, and periodic your dye shot and see whether you are has done a perforation. If it's not a perforation, I think you should see whether what is the communication. Anybody had experience like that?
By the way, there is a actually, I'm sort of quoting my husband. He was asking about this acquired coronary AV fistula, about this caused by cardiac surgeons. Well, actually, cardiac surgeons.
What I want to know is, you said that can some happen after cardiac surgery, but the commonest cause of coronary AV fistula are congenital.
That is, I would agree. Yeah.
Yeah, but then I only thing I can think of coronary AV fistula caused by cardiac surgeries, if a novice cardiac surgeon inadvertently grafts a graft to the coronary vein, then obviously you would cause iatrogenic coronary fistula. But the commonest cause of coronary AV fistula is congenital.
Yeah, but I think there are a couple of instances where the cardiac surgeon can cause that, and that is as a result of septal myectomy when you're operating on Hawkins. As on also apparently with the muscle bundle resection in operative repair of fellows. Now these are quite rare, but these have been described. So I don't think you can sort of comprehensively say that cardiac surgeons can't cause the problem. Occasionally they do. Okay, any other questions?
No, I also want to know now if what y'all say now, if the right coronary artery and the left coronary artery are involved, is dual double vessel disease, is it?
Yes, sir. Right coronary artery.
No,
no. What I'm saying is, if you have stenosis of the say LAD circumflex paired, but yes. Right is stenosis. Yes, I can understand calling it double vessel disease. But if you have both the all three LAD circumflex and the right coronary artery stenosis, would you call it a double vessel disease because anatomically there are only two vessels, or you would be call it a triple vessel disease because functionally there are three coronary arteries?
It's a triple vessel disease.
That's what I want to clarify.
The American Heart Association used the classification single vessel versus multi vessel. The other way of putting it out.
Yeah.
So as soon as they see the two vessels or three vessels, they categorize it as a multi vessel.
But from the surgical point of view, we consider it anatomically two vessels, functionally three vessels. That is how we surgeons just look at it when we are grafting, plus, of course, any major branches like diagonal.
We don't have any other questions in the chat box, no? Because this was a back to basics kind of program, we decided not to have any questions like we did in the previous talk. But if anybody has any queries about any of the views or anything like that, any of the senior registrars, I think they'd be, I would suggest you sort of clarify any doubts.
I'm Guruparan here. Yes. I'm Guruparan here. One of the other things that we can look at in the angiogram is the tissue myocardial perfusion grading, which is sometimes very useful to see whether a particular territory is viable or not, especially after a myocardial infarction. They also grade that into 0, 1, 2, 3, depending on the blush that we see and how quickly the dye gets washed out.
Yeah, I think you mentioned the blush. The myocardial blush, the 0, 1, 2, 3, because it is actually a prediction of prognosis as well. Because where you have a poor, because it is really mentioning that there's reduced microvascular involvement in when there's a poor blush. I think that I mentioned in Chatrika.
No, madam, no, I didn't elaborate on that actually regarding the myocardial blush. Yeah.
Okay, like that. I must have been looking at my lecture.
Dr. Mayuradhan, can I just make a point here?
Yeah.
It's regarding this again about the ramus intermedius. I think the ramus intermedius can take either diagonal course or obtuse marginal course. So I don't think it's necessarily it is the LAD course, diagonal course. So as somebody asked the question whether if there's a circumflexion in the circumflex and ramus intermedius, are you going to label it as double vessel disease? It's a little bit of a query, I think so. I don't know what our senior consultants view on this, because the LAD is a major artery. So are we going to label it as it? So it will be helpful to us also as consultants also. We can learn from other of our senior colleagues.
Then Chatrika, anything you want?
Madam, can I add some comments? Chatrika?
Yeah, sure.
Path here. Actually, Chaturika did a wonderful presentation. No doubt about it. And it's very well standard. And
Thank you, sir.
Very creative. So I will give actually 100% marks for you. Right?
Yeah.
Undoubtedly. And actually, I also learned a lot, you know, especially this double vessel disease about this ramus intermedius and all that. Previously, I have put it as, you know, because we had it as circumflex. So I also learned a few points. Thank you very much. Actually, wonderfully guided. And congratulations, I'm sure you will be a wonderful cardiologist in the future.
Okay, thank you very much, sir, for your appreciation.
Anindu, have you anything more to say?
Can I add a comment?
Yeah, please.
Can I add a comment?
Yes.
Yeah, congratulations, Chaturika, excellent presentation. One more thing, to highlight is the importance of hemodynamic monitoring during angiography, and the fact that always the blood pressure should be monitored at the time of cannulation of the coronary artery. and that can give a few clues whether there's osteal disease before you inject dye, because the pressure will damp. And also, if the pressure is damped while the catheter is in the aorta, always the possibility of air in the system. So for safe angiography, always you should check the one thing. If I have to add for the extreme beginners who are there, to always be alert about the hemodynamic system and the blood pressure before engaging the coronaries. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, that is particularly important, particularly as sometimes you know, there's the technician also might not be concentrating that much on the hemodynamic part, and so it is important that the operator, whatever it is ultimately your patient, that you should keep a sharp eye on that, because and also you might find that you find it difficult to find out exactly why it is damp. Usually it is because there's some air bubble stuck in one of the tubes. So you have to just check your entire system and make sure that the system is clear. And that is why the pressure actually gets damped. This is for the absolute beginners.
Actually, madam, I have to add something for that as well. I'm Bhatia again. One thing, of course, this austere severe lesion with dampening and also the air. Another thing, I had two patients who had got anaphylactic shock. Yeah, the pressure really damped. So this is one other thing that you need to remember. I think that's just to add on what Chandrika also told. Yeah.
And just another point is, again, for the beginners, when you're engaging an artery, sometimes the catheter gets lodged on the side of the artery. You have to be very, very careful, because you must always try to keep it axial. And you must be very careful about the dye injection, because at the time you can cause a dissection, an osteal dissection, which can be really quite... it can be quite lethal and quite fatal to the patient.
And if you see a lesion in the proximal segment, it's always better to give some GT and make sure that it's not spasm, no?
Yeah, that's very common with the right coronary artery, particularly.
Yeah. Dr. Yagathia, is about the coronary anomalies. Especially, we have the two conditions where the LA left main or LAD can go between the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. That can be identified on the angiogram. So those patients, we have to be careful, which you can pick very on special signs are there on angiograms, RAU, so that if you pick such a patient, to be make sure that you know that you have identified a life-threatening anatomical problem, which you can even confirm with the CT or cardiac CT or cardiac MRI.
If I were to add one more point to Chandrika, when the pressure is damped, it may be the catheter is king. So this is just a point for the very beginners. You have to always screen down, write down and see whether the catheter has got kinked.
So if the graft are occluded, if you think a post-CABG patient, would you do a coronary CT first or you will do an invasive angiogram? What is your sequence?
If you know the grafts are blocked, I'm of course not familiar with that.
Repeat the question again. If you know the grafts are, can you just repeat the question?
No, I was asking in a post-CABG patient for ischemic indications, you are thinking about angiogram.
Yeah.
And, so would you do a CT coronary angiogram first and, you know, and...
I don't think you'll do it first. You first do your angiogram. But the thing is, if you do have an issue with those grafts, then you can repeat it. You can, because very often we go ahead, we do the angiogram with the intention of probably doing a PCI at the same time. Because sometimes you might find that the native arteries are angioplastable or one of the grafts has got a blockage. But supposing you cannot identify the grafts, then the obvious thing is to go for a CT angiogram afterwards.
But in case that in CT angiogram, you can find that Lehmann graft is very well patent all throughout the course, the risk of, you know, dissecting the Lehmann with the invasive angiogram, that is one of the very risky thing, no? You can spare that.
Yeah, but the thing is, you know, nowadays we very often, instead of using the Lehmann catheter, we tend to use the RCA, which actually, you know, you don't have to stick it right into that Lehmann graft. you can get a pretty good visualization when you get reasonably close to it. That problem is there, but I think doing a CT angiogram just to go and identify the lemma is probably, I think it's a bit of an overkill. There are some more questions, by the way. This one person has asked about, let's see, there are several chat questions. Yeah, it was, yes. Is it advisable to mention raft ability in a coronary angiogram report? Well, that is, I think, up to the cardiologist who is writing the report. Most of the time, what we really do is we just say that the patient is suitable for CABG. And leave it to the surgeon to decide on what the graftable vessels are, because sometimes people get a little over enthusiastic and say, ask the surgeon to graft, you know, OM1, 2, 3, D1, D2 and all that, which is really not possible. There's also another question saying that the RCA, if the RCA is non-dominant and having an 80% stenosis in the normal left system, they're saying if the RCA is non-dominant and having an 80% stenosis and the left system is normal, should we consider it a single vessel disease? Over to you, Chaturika.
Yeah, we have to consider it as a single vessel disease, madam, because dominance won't matter in this situation. So that will be useful whether to decide we are going with an intervention or not. But still, it's a single vessel disease.
But I think, Chaturika, I think you have to still mention that is RCA is an undominant artery, because it will give a wrong message for the physicians and others, right? I think as a cardiologist, if you say single vessel disease for a non-dominant artery, I agree with what you say, but I think still mention that it's clinically non-significant or whatever, right? Because otherwise it will give a wrong message. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I also agree with that.
Yeah.
Somebody is asking about LV angiogram, no?
Yeah.
Routinely, but nowadays we are not doing that.
No, but actually, the days when we were doing all the, only femorally, we were routinely doing LV angiograms and they were really quite useful. It's just that you're giving a lot of contrast. That is the problem. And now we are pretty, especially the bulk of our patients are diabetics and they are also having a lot of, many of them are having nephropathy. The contrast has become an issue. So because of that, I think routine LV angiograms are not warranted, but certainly you can set up, you can choose your patient, because sometimes it can give you quite a bit of information.
Looking at the LV angiogram, now what they recommend is use a pigtail, not the normal catheters that we used to, just to push it down. Because in the UK, they had found more perforations trying to inject dye towards end hole catheter. So if you are trying to use the same catheter, that is not recommended now. So we have to change to a pigtail catheter, do a proper shot.
That's right. We used to do the femorals, it automatically used to pick the pigtail. No? So the thing, because there was no issues, which catheter change was always easier with the femoral approach. We didn't have these problems or spasms and things like that. And it was always easy to get in nozzle. In fact, we routinely did LV angios in virtually every patient during that era. UK and when I worked in, we did both the LAO and the ROV.
If my memory serves me right, it was really after Pramod's tragic problem that we stopped doing LV angios.
Not the radial approach.
No. We used to do the radial. If my memory serves me correct, but I think till then we were always doing.
Yeah, in our training also that routine part, no?
Yeah. Yeah, that was a good skill for people to have anyway. I think.
And also having development of ECMO machines, which gives very accurate pictures now. So we don't need the LV angiogram most of the time to get the same information.
Yeah.
Does the AP view, plain AP view helps, use? And any other views, especially left main?
Well, even then, it's not a very good view. I mean, the thing is, sometimes if you have a critical osteo left main with a absolute pressure damping, you might as well shoot with that view and get out.
Yeah, get out. Yeah.
But you find that the other arteries are quite, they're not separated out. And so it might be a bit of a problem for the, especially if the other arteries are also diseased, for the surgeon to identify, you know, where exactly to graft. Okay, shall we call it a day?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think I must thank Chaturika for very comprehensive lecture, and all the also the Javadan group team headed by Niyomali and Jagat for arranging it. I think for next, it's happy that we have got a very good, hitting up to 85, I think. So that is very good. Then I think next presentation will be in two weeks' time. And that, I think Mayuradharan's team volunteered to do that.
I think it's not Mayuradharan's team, it's Candy team.
Ah, Candy team, yes. Okay, right, good. But okay, right. So
I'd also like to thank our cardiothoracic colleagues also for joining in.
Oh yeah, sure. Even the cardiothoracic anesthetists are very keen
and
to
the anesthetist and the cardiac anesthetist. Yeah, I noticed right. Quite a few anesthetists were there.
Yeah,
thank you. Very useful. Thank you.
You were there ultimately.
No, she was there from the beginning, I think.
No, she
was there. There was a bit of a problem to join.
Yeah, I think there was a login issue.
Yeah.
I think we will go alternatively with non-interventional and interventional topics, no?
Yes.
As that's a very keep the interest, no? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think thank you very much. Also, Tamal and Aruna, as usual, because they have been
organizers. Yeah,
organizers. And Tamal want to put out a list of potential topics. I think we'll circulate it. Then we can see the appropriateness and, we can select the topics. Yeah. So thank you very much for joining and good night to you.
Okay, good night.
Good night.